Well, the Western Conference have just finished, and for the third time in four seasons, the Seattle Sounders is going to MLS Cup, and that this will now be the fifth straight year that we will have a MLS Cup featuring a Cascadia team. And, you know, as much as I know a lot of people are going to say this is definitely an upset, and that not a lot of people believe the fact that the Sounders was going to go to Bank of California Stadium and knock LAFC in this game, and that people feel like this was an absolute choke job by LAFC, which in some extent, yes, they kind of choked a little bit, and certainly Carlos Vela kind of choked in this performance by decided to not show up whatsoever in this game. But you got to give credit to the Sounders. And I really felt like, you know, they kind of played what exactly I thought was going to get them the victory in this game, which is they were being very physical in this game. They were trying to frustrate this LAFC attack with their physical play. They were playing some very good defense, and actually not just very good defense, but probably the best defensive performance I've seen the Sounders play all season long in this game. And also they had a match winner and a decider that was the reason why they won this game, and that decider and match winner is Raul Ruiz Diaz, who put an absolute clinic in this game. But before the start of this game, I wrote Marc-Anthony K was on the bench for LAFC, so it looks like he was available in this game. And he did, of course, came on later in this game, which I'll tell you what, when exactly he came on and why exactly he came on in just a bit. While Arriaga is going to start in this game in favor of Roman Torres for the Sounders, and I was kind of a little bit nervous when this was going to be the case. And throughout this game, yeah, it kind of proved my nervousness, and I'm pretty sure a lot of Sounders fans was kind of on their edge of this of their seat every time they see Arriaga do something very sinister and almost cost their team the game in this one. But you know, in the early bit of this game, once again, LAFC looked flat going forward on the attack, and that, you know, they definitely had more possession this time than they did against the Galaxy in the early part of the game, but they still look very flat, and there was really nothing going on for their attack early on. Although, to be fair, Seattle, you know, they also kind of looked flat early on, and that, you know, in the early bits, it was kind of a little bit cagey, which is not a big surprise, because when you have such a high-stake kind of game, that usually happens in these circumstances. But things did start to get physical early in the game, and the referee, of course, letting go a couple of calls. And I know by the end of tonight, a lot of LAFC fans are going to be complaining about the referee and that there were some calls that should have been called, and that there was a couple penalty kind of appeal that was denied by the referee, and some of them, you could argue that it should have been a penalty. But I feel like when I look at how this game plays out, you know, I don't think the referee really plays a big part of the fact that LAFC lost this game. And certainly, the referee did not cause LAFC to lose the game. And that's been the case throughout this postseason, where as much as I've seen some referee letting go some calls and letting go some physical kind of play that you would think it's usually called in the regular season, I kind of like the fact that they let them go, because it will give more flow to the game, and that it just does not disrupt the flow to the game, where, you know, in the playoffs, when you have a good flow of the game, that is usually when you get a very exciting game, and this one was no exception to that. And as a result, this was kind of an exciting matchup. Now, LAFC did get the opening goal in the 16th minute, and it was Atuesta that actually scored a free kick. And as much as this was a great free kick, there was definitely some controversy leading up to this free kick goal, where it looked like Carlos Vela kind of embellished a little bit, and that, you know, Arriaga fouled Vela just outside of the box, but it looked like when Vela kind of did a little spin move on Arriaga, it seemed like he kind of went down a little bit too easily, and that it probably should have not been a free kick, but it was given a free kick, and that Altuesta with a lovely strike to put the ball into the back of the net. And just like that, LAFC went up 1-0. And in some way, I thought it was kind of against the run of play because I thought the Sounders, they looked like the better team early on. And that LAFC really didn't have any chance besides this goal that they scored. Like, this was really the first chance they had in front of goal, and they were able to take advantage of it. But that lead, of course, did not last long because 6 minutes later, Raul Ruiz Diaz, who I mentioned, he had an absolute clinic, and definitely he's going to be the man of the match in this game. Scores from Ladero to tie the game up at one apiece. Before 4 minutes later, it's Nico Ladero scoring from Jovan Jones. Great break and finishing from Nico Ladero, but I also want to question the LAFC defense in this game. Like, why in the world did they decide to kind of just back off and let Ladero take a pot shot from 20 yards out? Like, the last guy you want to let someone wide open just outside of the box and try to take a shot at goal would be Nicolas Ladero. And because of the fact that they did not close him down whatsoever and leaving him acres of space to try to put one into the back of net, they were royally punished by that. And yeah, the Sounders, of course, were up 2-1 in this game. And I also wrote this game might not be a low-scoring game because as much as the Sounders scored two quick goals, I thought LAFC were eventually going to wake up on attack. And that something tells me this could be a very high-scoring kind of matchup, which in some way I was actually kind of also worried about the Sounders because if they do get into a high-scoring kind of matchup, it probably would not be favoring them, knowing the fact that LAFC, they love to get into a match that is kind of high-scoring, and usually they come out that high-scoring matchup with a win. But after that, the Sounders, despite the fact that I thought LAFC was going to wake up on attack, the Sounders kind of did a good job nullifying this LAFC attack, and that this LAFC attack just never got going into this game. Maybe, I think, right near the last 10 minutes of the game is when LAFC started to kind of look a little bit themselves, where they're able to get behind this back line of the Sounders. But throughout this game, this Sounders defense absolutely shut down this LAFC attack. They absolutely shut down Carlos Vela, Diego Rossi, and all the weapons that LAFC had in this game. And that in the 36th minute, Arriaga actually shoulder charged Vela in the box, and there was no penalty kick awarded. This was one of many controversial penalty kick call that kind of gone against LAFC, but I thought this one was a clean kind of challenge. And there was actually earlier in the game where Arriaga once again shoulder charged Vela, but there was nothing that was being called in that instant. And that I like the fact that if there was nothing called in that instant, then this obviously should not be called because it's kind of the same play where it was just kind of a shoulder to shoulder kind of challenge. And I like the fact that the referee did not award the penalty in that instant. Now, in the 43rd minute, Latif Blessing did get subbed off in this game for an injury, but Marc-Anthony Kay does come on, and this is where I talk about how Marc-Anthony Kay did came on in this game, and he came on not because of a tactical substitution, but because he had to replace someone that is injured in this game. And I'll tell you what, there's not many times where you could say that a team lose one of their best weapon in attack and they replace with another their best weapon on the attack. That is how stacked this LAFC team is, and that is how good in terms of the depth that this team has. Although, to be fair, as much as we talk about how good the depth of this team and how, you know, they have so many weapons going forward, as I mentioned before, they were just completely notified by the Sounders defense. And, you know, that kind of free-flowing attack that we've seen throughout this season was kind of non-existent in this game. Now, Arriaga has, I also wrote right before halftime, Arriaga has really been living life on the edge with his defending, and that he was still making some very kind of just borderline to be called a foul by the referee. And that, you know, I thought eventually he was going to get paid for in terms of some of the silly challenge that he made in this game. And he this this, what he has done in the first half where he shoulder charged a couple of players that probably should have been called a foul, and that there was a couple of very sketchy play that should have been called foul in the regular season, and that there was controversy surrounding him in terms of committing foul against a couple of LAFC players would continue into the second half. And that in some way he was kind of also in the center of attention in terms of a penalty kick called that clearly should have gone against him. But before I talk about that, in the second half, LAFC definitely looked like they were the better side in the early bit, and things continued to get physical between both of these teams. And despite the fact that LAFC looked like they were the better side, they were still not really creating a lot of chances, and that they were possessing the ball a lot and kind of controlling the game, but they weren't really getting behind the Sounders back line, and there wasn't really a lot of time when Stephen Fry really had to make a couple of decent saves to bail out this Sounders back line. And then the Sounders kind of came into life, and there was two incidents in the 57th minute that they could have easily made it 3-1. First, it was Ruiz Diaz almost made it 3-1 with a shot that just went wide. Then 30 seconds later, Lidero tried to chip Tyler Miller from 50 yards out, but unfortunately that chip was just over the bar. And judging by the fact that Tyler Miller kind of did get back onto his line in time before that ball actually hit over the bar, I kind of had a feeling that even if that chip was on target, maybe Tyler Miller is going to get back in time and tip that one over. But yeah, that was almost a spectacular goal, and certainly one of the best goals we have ever seen in the playoffs if Ladero was able to chip Tyler Miller and score from 50 yards out. But eventually the Sounders did make it 3-1 when, guess who? Ruiz Diaz scores from Ladero. I mean, I also wrote both are putting on a show. I mean, I know as much as the center of attention is going to be on Ruiz Diaz with the way that he not only contributed in terms of the goal scoring, but also make some very good defensive play for this game. Let's not forget Ladero, he was on his A game too, and he was, you know, scoring goals and also being that playmaker that he is considered one of the best playmaker in the league, and that both of these guys really just put on a show and really just shows you how when are they are at their best and when they're really on, nobody can stop both of these guys. Not even the best team in the league can stop these two guys if they really feel like they are up for this game, and that they, of course, would create some magical moment. Then in the 68th minute, as I mentioned earlier, of Arriaga was kind of playing with fire and living life on the edge with defending. Well, here in the 68th minute, he looked like he handballed the ball in the box, but no penalty kick that was called. And I believe, was it Diamande that kind of tried to hit that one into the back of the net, and the ball kind of popped up into Arriaga's hand. And when I look at the way that the ball kind of hit Arriaga's hand, yeah, I kind of feel like that should have been called a handball, because he kind of extended his arm a little bit, and that we've seen many times before that when a player handballed the ball in the box, and not only your hand is in an unnatural position, but you extend your arm to handball that, that usually are being called in the regular season. But it wasn't called in this instant, and that 4 minutes later, we almost had a very similar situation where it looked like Kim Ki-hee kind of extended his arm when the ball struck his hand. Once again, no penalty that was being called, and I know LAFC fans are going to be very frustrated about these two calls, and they think these are the two calls that's going to be that robbed them the victory. But let's also not forget that they kind of got gifted in the 15th minute, and that, you know, that free kick that Atuesta, of course, was able to score to give them a 1-0 lead probably shouldn't have been a free kick if the referee would have realized that Vela kind of went to ground very easily. And in some way, it kind of evens out in terms of some of the calls that have gone against both of these teams. And there's been many calls in this game that not only wasn't being called, but also kind of called against them. So, I just don't see how, despite the fact that there was some referee decision that kind of maybe could have altered the game, I just don't think that it really just downright say that the referee with these bad calls is the reason why the losing team lost this game in this. I mean, I've seen in the regular season that there is even more outrageous call that has gone against one of the team and gone against the losing team. And that, of course, was the reason why they lost compared to what we saw tonight. Now, after when the referee did not award a penalty for LAFC, despite the fact that Kim Ki-hee, of course, handballed it, that's when LAFC fan decided to throw trash onto the field again. And I'm not going to once again reiterate the fact that, you know, as much as I know, everybody's going to say, oh, yep, here you go. There's the LAFC fans once again acting like they are just incredibly insane and just decide to throw bottles onto the pitch and decide to trash their own field, and that they are just an absolute fuck. And that I'm not going to explain again that just because I've seen this happen a couple of times for LAFC doesn't mean that their entire fan base is an absolute fuck, and that this is just a minority of people that, of course, does it. But obviously, I know because of the way that this fan base have done it so many times that you can definitely see why people think that they are a fuck, and that, you know, MLS should definitely do something in terms of either just banning a section of the fans where they, of course, are not allowed to attend a game, or just play a game, an LAFC home game behind closed door because of the fans' behavior that this fan base have suffered. You know, I don't know if that, of course, is going to happen, but if MLS is going to have to solve this problem, and that, as I mentioned, this is not the first time we've seen LAFC fans throw stuff on to the pitch, I think until the league do something about this, this is going to be something that is going to continue. And I also wrote LAFC attack look completely out of sorts, and that kind of really sums up in terms of the way that they just never got going in terms of the attack. I mean, in the 81st minute, I thought that was really the first time where they really kind of got behind this Seattle's back line, and that Leardown had to foul one of the LAFC player and receive the first yellow card of the game. And that in the 85th minute, despite the fact that LAFC finally started to figure out on the attack, Seattle almost closed the door on them and made it 4-1. If only Brad Smith wasn't being very selfish and took the shot instead of passing to a wide open Nuhu that could have just easily tapped it in to make it 4-1. Now, Nuhu did have a chance in stoppage time to get his first ever goal in first ever goal for the Seattle Sounders, but unfortunately it was denied by Tyler Miller. But still, you know, the Sounders was able to comfortably walk away with a 3-1 victory. And in terms of the shots in this game, 14 shots compared to 11 that the Sounders had, 5 shots on goal compared to the 4 that LAFC had, 6 shots off target compared to the 7 that LAFC had, no shots that was blocked compared to 3 that LAFC had. And despite the fact that LAFC had 70% possession compared to 30% possession, they were not being very kind of productive in terms of the possession. And that, how many times I've been saying that possession doesn't mean anything in a game unless if you decided to not be productive in terms of those possession. And as long as you don't get the ball behind the opponent back line with those possession that you have, it doesn't really mean much at all in this game. And that, you know, for LAFC, that was kind of the story of this game, where, you know, I kind of want to say they underestimated Seattle a little bit, but that kind of also doesn't really give a lot of credit in terms of the Sounders defense. That was absolutely amazing, but, you know, they just didn't show up in this game. Like, when they, throughout the season, where their attack has been just unstoppable, and that so many of their weapons has been able to prevail, even if things are not looking well for LAFC. But tonight, simply, none of those weapons kind of show up. And that, you know, again, you got to give a lot of credit to the Sounders, where I really think they kind of play exactly what I thought that they were going to do in terms of getting a victory, which is they notified this LAFC attack with that physical play. And they also have some match winner of their own to able to get get those crucial goals to move on to MLS Cup. So, yeah, congratulations to the Seattle Sounders winning Western Conference title once again. And now they, of course, will be going to MLS Cup and potentially hosting MLS Cup at CenturyLink Field, depending on if Toronto FC can beat Atlanta, and that they're looking to trying to chase their second title in their franchise history. And we could also potentially have a MLS Cup matchup where it could really be Seattle versus TFC for the third time in 4 years. And I know some people are kind of tired with the fact that, I kind of feel like we want to see other teams play, and that some people will say, well, this is an example of why MLS doesn't really have parity. Well, the thing is that I still feel like MLS have parity, even though technically this playoffs haven't really shown, because of the fact that none of the founding teams in MLS actually make it to the conference final for the first time in league history. But I just feel like this is just kind of like a one-off, and until if we continue to see almost the same team in the conference final, then I think maybe that parity kind of level started to go away in terms of the league, which is not really a bad thing, because if you look at many leagues around the world, there isn't really a lot of parity around the world, and that you usually always get the big teams that is right there always on the top. And it seemed like, you know, when you look at the conference final, that is pretty much the case with all four of these teams that consider are the big team, and the team that is kind of the giants of MLS if parity is no longer a thing. But going back to what I said about how I don't think a TFC versus Seattle kind of rematch would be bad, is because unlike the first two matchup where I think a lot of people thought that they were going to go to MLS Cup, and that, you know, this was a matchup that a lot of people thought it would be, I don't think a lot of people thought that this year this was going to be the matchup for MLS Cup. Like, if you tell me that we're going to have TFC versus Seattle again for the third time in 4 years, you would think that it would be crazy. You know, not because both teams are bad, but because, you know, the Sounders, throughout the season, there's been a lot of question of the fact that if they suffer one injury on their team, then this team just does not look as star-studded. And that, you know, they've been very, very fortunate this postseason in terms of not suffering a lot of crushing injury to some of their key players. And then you also have TFC that I thought that they were going to be rebuilt this year, and yet now they're just 90 minutes away from going back to MLS Cup. And it'll be interesting to see with this upset that has happened in tonight's match, will we actually see another upset in tomorrow's match between Atlanta versus TFC? But stay tuned for that, as we'll find out tomorrow who exactly will be the other team and the team from the Eastern Conference that will be representing or the other team from the Eastern Conference that's going to be representing that conference in MLS Cup, and that we're going to find out what is this year MLS Cup matchup is going to be. But either way, hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you do, make sure you guys leave a like, smash that subscribe button, and yeah, I of course will see you guys next time.